All right. It's that time again. What you say? It's Bible study time. Time to come out and just talk to the Lord about it. Put that on the phone for me. Time to talk to the Lord about it and allow Him to just move in our lives the way that we want Him to move. And it's just a blessing to be able to come with Bible study once again tonight. Thank you, Lord, for it. Before we get too far into His Word, we got to bring Him into the presence of this dwelling. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for who you are, for what you're about to do. Father, you said, study, let's show ourselves approved. A workman need not be ashamed, but rightly divide your word. Father, as we divide your word tonight, I ask that you move all harm, hurt, and danger from us, God, that we'll be able to just sit down in peace. Hear your word, Lord God, as it stir up the spirit in us. In the name of Jesus, Lord Jesus, I decrease right now. As you begin to increase in my life, God, help me to be the shepherd of the people that's listening, God, that I may move them, God, with your spirit and the Holy Spirit to helping me move the people, that I will be able to go into that spirit, Lord God, and that inner stuff, God, and fight it and rip it apart and bring in your word, God, because there is some bond in Gilead. And because of it, Lord God, I thank you for what you're about to do tonight. Thank you, Father, just allowing us to have this opportunity again to rightly divide your word. This do now, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Saints, I want you to turn in your Bibles, if you would. Go to the book of Isaiah. We're gonna travel a little bit tonight, Saints. We're gonna move about this Bible a little bit tonight. And I just thank God because we talked about comforting the people last week. We was in Isaiah as well. Isaiah 40 to be a fact. But I want to talk to you from Isaiah 43. As God begin to bless us, as He begin to move us. And I'm just so thankful for tonight. Come on. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Isaiah and go to chapter 43. If some of you are trying to get somebody to come on, we'll talk just a minute, briefly. But I want you to tell them, come on, Bible study is on. Share. Tell them Bible study is on. It's time to hear from the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're about to do in this house and in this internet. I just thank God for this internet. I reach out to you and just touch you where you are and know exactly what you're going through in the name of Jesus. We're in the book of Isaiah, the 43rd chapter of the book of Isaiah. And I just want to skim through Isaiah 43. Won't try to cover the whole book of Isaiah 43, but just some things that I want you to take a look at tonight. Because as we begin to move, I want you to hear this. As we begin to move and have the beings of Jesus in front of us, it's just a mighty thing. It's a powerful thing. But he says here in Isaiah chapter 43, but now thus say the Lord who creates you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel. He says, fear not, for I have redeemed you. Now that's good news right there. He said, I have redeemed you. Whatever you're going through, God said, I have already redeemed you. He said, I call you by your name. And then God shows you and I what we mean to him. He says, you are mine. Good gracious. So we belong to Jesus. So if you're a non-believer and you're not following God, I ask you and I urge you tonight, listen to this word, because there's something in this word that's going to touch your heart to help you to understand God's movements even more. But he comes here and he says, you are mine. He identifies us as being his. But I want you to go all the way down to verse 11, Isaiah 43 and 11, he says, I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. So I want you to understand, I don't know who you're serving, but if you're not serving our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, then it's time for you to kind of back up and says, hey, will that God I'm serving be there for me? Will that God I'm serving walk with me, talk with me, pull me through my situation? Will that God who can kill my body and give me another life in eternity, will that God do that? And if you can't answer that with yes, 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 and yes, then you say, okay, Pastor, talk to me about this Jesus that you are talking about. I'm glad you asked me that. He said, I have declared and saved. I have proclaimed, and there is no foreign God among you. Therefore, you are my witness, says the Lord, that I am God. Indeed, before the days were, I am he. Okay. And then he says, and there is no one who can deliver out of my hands. And watch this part. This is where it is so beautiful. He said, I work, and who will reverse it? That means that when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ
begins to move on your behalf. He begins to work it out for you. He begins to do some things for you. Nobody will be able to reverse what Jesus Christ has done for you. It's just a powerful thing. It's so good. But I want you to understand before I get too deep in this thing, some have lost a degree of faith based on a particular situation or circumstance that's happening in your life. Some find it hard to set goals based on the failure of a few mishaps in your life. Mishaps like relationship failures, and mishap that has become bitter within those relationships, and mishap that stays to yourself. You begin to become an introvert. You begin to stay to yourself, and you don't put up with others like you used to, because another person has taken your kindness for weakness, and they have caused you to become an introvert. And because of that, God sent me here to tell you. He says, indeed, before the day was, I am he, and there is no one who delivers you out of my hand. I work, and who will reverse it? Because some of us have lost so much financial stability. You've lost your job, and you can't hold on to the finances like you used to. And that has become a problem, and now you feel abandoned. You feel abandoned to finances. It's like finances can't find you, and you're trying to understand what's happening in my life. But God says, I work, and who can reverse it? He's getting ready to bless us. He's getting ready to move us. But I want you to understand this. Look down all the way to verse 18. Isaiah 43 and 18. He says, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. See, what happens is, we like to look at where we failed. We like to look at why we failed, and we like to look at, this is going to be me forever. People have spoken over your life and didn't tell you the truth. People are trying to put negativity in your life and not put anything positive. So God is telling me and you now, don't remember the former things, not consider the things of old. Because of the former loss and because of the former things that we've already put up with, some have become mentally hijacked. Yeah, you become mentally hijacked. Has left us feeling homeless, the homeless of feelings. And it also ensure that we are no longer trusting like we should. Not trusting in God, not trusting in anyone, because we're mentally hijacked. It has pulled, has taken something from us where we should have confidence in no lies. Confidence no is not there any longer. We're not sure if love lives there anymore. And some have been brought on a strong struggle that they're going through, and you feel like God is not there. Trying to push things through this hardship of losing someone is a hard thing to do, because we got to understand that God loves us. But this mindset brings on a loss of power because of the intimacy with God that has compromised us through the infiltration of the circumstances in the situations that we have gone through. It has left you to the point where you want to believe in God, but you can't really go there with God because of the intimacy you used to have. It's infiltrated by your circumstances and your situations because you lost a loved one that you thought was going to be there forever, or you lost your best friend, or things from COVID or overtrial has caused a separation that caused you to not think that God was there to pull that person out of the situation. So the intimacy that we had with God, that we loved the Lord, something has allowed the loved one that we truly love, that we thought was going to be there, it's gone now. And what do we do? Our minds feel mentally hijacked. But I want to read something to you in Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 tells us that, surely, 53 and 4 tells us that he has borne our grief and carried our sorrow, yet we esteem him strictly, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. We are like shepherds that have gone astray. So see, God sees what you're going through. And he knows how to fix your situation. He is going to help you. But he told me to tell you here in Isaiah 55, verse 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near.
Let the wicked forsake his ways, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God.
For he will abundantly pardon. Watch this part. I like this. It helps us out. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, said the Lord. So God is letting you and I know, him and you and I, me and him, we don't think alike. God is going to help you. He is going to bless you. He is going to work it out. He is going to move. Where you think there's sorrow, God is bringing in joy. Where you think there's weakness, God is bringing in strength. Where you think that you're about to give up, there's no more help for you, here come mega help to pull you out of your situation. He tells us here, he says, behold, Isaiah 43 in verse 19, he says, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not even know it?
So he's saying, tell my people, I am about to do a new thing in their lives. Oh, man, we're here in January 2022.
God has sent me here tonight to tell you, hey, hold on, wait. I'm about to do a new thing
in your life,
and shall you not even know it? See, you won't know it because you're so fed up and so frustrated with the things that has come against you, that has allowed you to feel broken, that has allowed you not to raise up
to the level of prosperity,
the level of compassion, the level of faith that you thought you would. And because of that, it has you bombarded, beat down, and left your feelings homeless. You don't know where to put your feelings anymore, because where you used to put your feelings, that door is locked. Where you used to lay down your head and put your feelings, it no longer is there. What's happening to me, and why do I feel this way? And that's why God says, I am ready to do a new thing in you, and shall you not know it?
He says, I will even make a road in the wilderness for you.
You know, the wilderness is a dreadful thing. And the wilderness is to a point where while you're in the wilderness, you are exposed to so much devastation. You are exposed to so much humiliation. You are exposed to so much hardship. And you are exposed to so much lack while you were in the wilderness. But God says to tell my people, I will make a road
in the wilderness and a river in the desert.
Good gracious, that means that in your dry places where it looks like nothing is going to work for you, where it looks like all hope is gone, where it looks like I lost my loved one, and how am I going to make it from day to day, and how I'm going to get through this. God says, I'm going to show you a new thing, and I'm going to bring you out of that situation, and I'm going to help you in your dry places by bringing a river through that dry place. That means nourishment.
That means prosperity. That means the things that he's wanting to bring to you.
God says, all I need for you to do is just believe in me. Boy, you're going to make me sit back on that one. He says, just believe in me. All we got to do is just believe in God. Whew. See, some of us think that the God we serve is just a wimp, that he won't help us. He's afraid to move here. He's afraid to move there. He won't do this. Where is God in this situation? But do you not know that when God got on that cross and he stretched out his arms and he said it's finished, he took on the sins of the world, of every mankind. Jesus took on the sins of everyone. So if he took the sins of everyone, what makes you think what you're going through is too powerful for Jesus? Come on now. Come on now. You got to hear me.
The God that we serve,
he said, I created the heavens and the earth.
I created the stars and the moon.
And watch this, is how bad it is. He said, I destroyed the world.
Good gracious. He said, I'm going to destroy it again, but this time
I'm going to bring in fire because I need to burn some things off of us. He says, I will make a river in your desert. He said, the beasts of the field will honor me, and the jackals
and the ostrich, because I gave water in the wilderness and the rivers
in the dirt in the desert. In other words, he's saying, whatever has been bestiality coming towards you, trying to hurt you, trying to pull from you, he says, I've already tamed that for you. He said, an ostrich, when they reach out their neck and they're trying to get that water the long way, he said, I'm going to bring everything to you. He said, because what you've lost, he says, I'm going to fix. He says, what has come against you, I'm going to come against it. I, the Lord, have spoken. Then he says here, Isaiah 61:7 says, instead of your shame, you have a double honor. And instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. Good gracious alive. When I bring that river through your desert. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. When I bring that river through your desert. He said, I bring water into your wilderness, you know, to wash you of all that impurities and wash you of all that uncleanliness and wash you of all of that stuff that has you bound. You know, that stuff that has you to the point where, man, you can't hardly get up the next day because there's so much coming against you and you're trying to figure out, how do I make it through this day? But you got to understand that God sees what you're going through and God is going to pull you out of your situation. He is going to work it out for you. But sometimes God wants us to realize that, hey, I serve a God that's a God of strategy. Because sometimes you're praying that God bless you right now, but God has already given you your heart desire. He's already given you what you need, but he's waiting on you to have intimacy with him. What am I talking about? I'm talking about a relationship with him. He wants you to have that relationship. You know, the kind of relationship that whatever you're going through, you're going to put him first. Not you go do it, mess up, then bring Jesus in. That's kind of like putting the cart before the horse. That's not how Jesus works.
He said, put me first in everything that you do.
He said, pray without ceasing. And then he said, you know what? When I leave, Jesus said, when I leave, I'm going to send you a comforter. And with that comforter, it's going to be called the Holy Spirit. He's going to be there to lead and guide you through your every situation. So I want to ask you tonight, today, just yesterday or in this morning, did you put Jesus first in everything that you've done, even with that co-worker that made you angry? You say, if you say something to me today, I'm going to get to him, or I'm going to give it to him. Let them come out their mouth wrong today. Today, I'm going to give it to him. Did you put Jesus first? Because Jesus said you should love even them. Or did you say, that thing one more time to me and get the thorn in your neck from side to side? You say, I'm going to get to him. Let them say, I'm tired of them. Well, God says, if you put me first, vengeance is mine, said the Lord. Guess what? You don't have to get your hands dirty. I'm trying to tell you, we serve a God that's vengeful. Woo! See how I said that word? He's vengeful. That means that God loves us so much that he is so vengeful that who's ever coming against his children, he says, I'm coming against them because these are my children. These are mine. Children, it's kind of like you parents that's listening to me. If somebody out there in your yard and they just messing with your child and hurting your child and pushing your child down and pushing your child all over the yard and stuff, here you come and you see that and you hear your child crying, you're going to come out there and say, hey, stop messing with my child. Turn around and go back in the house and leave like that. Certainly that's not true. You're going to become a vengeful parent. Woo! What I'm talking about? You're coming out there and says, hey, put your hands on my child again and watch how I raise up on you. See, that's what Jesus is saying to Satan. Put your hands on my child again and watch me raise up. See, because Satan is trying to push you down. He's trying to hurt you. He's trying to beat on you. He's in your yard. He's just throwing stuff at you and just trying to make you do all kind of craziness and foolishness. But God has come to your door. He says, let my child alone. He's a vengeful God. Why? Because he said, that's my child. He says, in him I truly love. And God says this, greater is he that is in him than he that's in this world. Satan, leave my daughter alone. Satan, leave my child alone. For you see something that you really are not ready for. I've already kicked you out of heaven. Don't make me kick you out of this yard. Because if I kick you out of this yard, Satan, you're never ever going to be able to return again. But that's the God we serve. He's going to kick him out the yard anyhow. Because he don't want him there. Because when you get intimacy with God, that means you say, Lord, I hold nothing from you. I want to let you in. I want to ask you this question tonight. How many of you have gotten so intimate with God debt. You're too afraid to let him in your house. I'm talking about your earthly house. You're too afraid to let him in your earthly house. And some of us, your garage is in a disarray. You don't want God to go in your garage, so you close the door. I'm talking about in your heart. You don't want God to go into that closet where you got stuff all disarray, so you close the door. Jesus, you can come in, but you can't go to the garage, Jesus, and you can't go to the closet. Why are you saying this to Jesus? Because all Jesus wanted to do is go in and put that garage in order. Go in and put that closet in order. That's all the God that you serve wanted to do. In other words, let him into your heart. Let him into your house. Let him into your head. Let him into your thought process. Let him in. He's not there to talk bad about you, but he comes to straighten that closet out. He comes to straighten that garage out. In other words, he comes to straighten your life out. He comes to straighten those thoughts out. He wants to be intimate with you so that when you begin to call upon the name of Jesus, he says, that's my child. That's my son. And I love him because I gave my life for my child, for my children. That's how much he loves us. And then he says in John 15 and verse 7, if you abide in me and my word remain in you, I'll give you your heart desire. That's the God we serve. He said, whatever you want, my son, whatever you want, my daughter, I've already had it laid up for you. Then he smiles at us and says, you know what? I take pleasure in the prosperity of my children. Good gracious, I love it. I love it, I love it, I love it. He says, I take pleasure in the prosperity of my children. You see, that's why I keep telling the church, we got to stop begging God. You don't have to beg him. All you got to do is just obey him. You don't have to beg him. See, those that are begging God, Lord, please, Lord, when you going to help me? Lord, when you going to work it out? Lord, I'm going through this. Can't you see what I'm going through? Lord, please help me out of this situation. See, those are the ones that don't have an intimacy relationship with God. Oh, no. I didn't say that. Yes, I did. Those are the ones that doesn't have an intimate relationship with God. Because if you did, you wouldn't have to beg him. You say, Jesus, look at your son. Jesus, look at your daughter. Look what I'm going through. And guess what? You'll say, I know my daddy got it. I know my father got it. You know, I got a daughter. I got two daughters. Both of them know when they say, daddy, he come a running. Why? Because they know that I'm there to give them everything that I have based on my limitations that I can provide. They know that when they call daddy through thick and thin, here come daddy running to give them everything that he has based on his limitations. What about when they say, daddy? And I'm like, you know what? I don't feel like being bothered with you today. Go somewhere. You know, my mama used to tell me, well, go somewhere and sit down somewhere. You know, sometimes, you know, we tell our children, get somewhere and sit down somewhere. Leave me alone. I'm tired. I've been working all day. I don't feel like being bothered with you. But you know what? The God that you serve would never do you like that. Because he already knows what you're in need of before you ask him. So he wants you to ask him of things. So that when you do ask him, he says, you know what? I'm going to help you. I'm going to bless you. So when you say, daddy, Jesus, I need you, he comes running because he already knows what you've been through. He already knows what you had to put up with on that job. Woo! Oh, that's a mind. Woo. He already knows about the minefields that you have been walking through all of that day. At some point, it blew up in the mall. At some point, it blew up at the garage. At some point, it blew up by that driver going by you and it'll cut you off. That minefield that you're walking through called life, sometimes it'll detonate and it'll blow up in the areas that you don't want to blow up in. And when it blow up, you got to act like somebody. Now, here you are, caught on camera, acting a fool. Because you don't have an intimacy with God. He says, be angry, but sin not. Because sometimes you get so angry, you kind of want to lash out. You kind of want to let them know who they're dealing with. But remember, he said, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. So who you used to be, that's who you used to be. But you're a new thing now. Woo! You're a new creation now. All things have washed away. Behold, you are a new thing. Because if you were that old one, you would have handled that situation, that minefield that blew up. You would have handled that thing a little different. But because you're a new creation, whoa, because you're a new creation, You got to say, God, you got to handle this, because if you let me handle it, I know I got to get a lawyer. I got to get somebody to pull me out of this jail cell, Lord. So I'm just going to let you handle it, Jesus. And then watch this. When you fail, when you fall back, and then you say, Lord, you handle. Your naysayers are going to say, you're weak. You can't handle the situation. How you going to stand back and talk about Jesus, help this? You should be doing something with your own hand. See, that's Satan trying to get you to move based on his thought process. But Jesus said, bring me into everything that concerns you so that I can fix your situation. So when that minefield has blown up, poof, and you said, Jesus, handle this explosion that just happened in my life. Jesus said, I got it, my son. Just sit back and watch me work. Watch me do it. Because remember, I read up here, he says, I work and who will reverse it? That means that whatever he's doing, nobody will be able to reverse it. And so when you sit back, you say, God's got this situation. I'm not even going to worry about it. I'm going to give it over here. But the naysayer said, nah, man, you shouldn't let her talk to you like that. You shouldn't do this, man. Nah, you go at her, man. Nah, say this to him. Say that to him. You was a wimp. You dissed that and the other. But Jesus said, be quiet. Be still and know that I'm God. I will fix this situation. I will work it out. And so your hands are over your heart because you're saying, God, this thing is heartfelt to me. But my fist is balled up that I want to give it to him. But my hands is in praise mode because I know, God, you'll pull me out of this situation yet again. Oh, yeah, yet again. Why? Because we've already pulled you out of some minefields that exploded, that blew up right in your face. Right at the time, you thought you was walking step by step. You thought you was walking step by step and line by line. You thought that, and you was doing just that. And then here come an explosion. Boom. One that you was not ready for. Couldn't got him out of it. And that thing exploded. And when it did explode, it took away some of your finances. It took away some of your peace. It exploded. And it took away someone you truly loved. How am I going to get through this situation? How am I going to make it now? I thought they was going to be here with me forever. And I thought, Lord, that I, Lord, would leave before they would based on how I'm handling myself, God. That person loved you. That person was right there for you, God. How can you take them but not me, God? How are you going to work this thing out for me? You see, we have to understand. Every man is appointed once to die and once to be judged. We don't know when we leave. But what we have to do is make sure our every thought, our every decision, and our every feelings is geared toward God. Yes, you lost a loved one. Yes, you're hurting right now. Yes, COVID got your loved ones in the hospital and you don't know the outcome. But he says the effective, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. It's powerful and effective for those that's still living, but for those that's gone. That Christ has brought him in home. You got to say, Lord, I hurt, but thank you for bringing in your child. Thank you, Lord, that you helped me through this situation. And Lord, I know it's going to be a time that you're going to pull my flower in this valley. And I know that I'm going to leave someone hurting. But at the same time, God, help me get through this hardship. Help me to make it through, God, because I know you will. Because I have a relationship with you. Not only do I have a relationship, I have confidence in you. That's why he says in Hebrews 10 and verse 35, don't you lose your confidence in me, which bring great reward and recompense. He said, I will love you. He said, I will work it out. But all of us are going to leave here one day. And so I'm asking you now, because I done lost loved ones. I done lost loved ones that was very close to me. Try to push that anger away from you. And let's not blame God any longer. Because it was just their time. All of us are going to leave here. We just don't know how we're going to leave here. Some in car accidents, some through sickness, some through all kind of stuff. We don't know how we're going to leave here. But that's why he says, the joy of the Lord is my strength and my salvation. That's why he says, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So let's stop fussing at God. And wondering if God loves us. And wondering if God's going to help us. Because he pulled someone out of our life. We got to keep pushing. We got to keep knowing that God, you're going to save me the same way you saved my loved one. Help me out of this situation. Because I know you're going to bless me. He says, because I gave water in the wilderness, river in the desert, to give drink to my people. This one I love. My chosen people. This people I have formed for myself, but shall declare my praise. He says, Isaiah 43, verse 21, this people I have formed for myself. God says, I have formed you for myself. The loved one that's passed on, he said, I formed them for myself, but I'm just ready to bring them back home to myself. God has that prerogative to bring home who he wants to whenever he wants to. And God is big enough that we can be angry at him, and he'll still love you because he feels your sorrow. Remember, Jesus wept. Jesus felt sorrow. He knew what we was going through. When they beheaded John the Baptist, he wept. But I do want you to understand, God cares about everything that we goes through. See, we have to leave here. There is no way we can stay here forever. This world will be so overpopulated, good God, that there will be no movement. So God has to pluck the flower of someone every day and bring them back to us. We have to say, okay, God, you are too powerful to make a mistake. So I want you to know, I know your heart is hurting, you lost a loved one, things are not like it used to be, and you're trying to find your way out of this situation. You feel like you've been mentally hijacked. Your feelings are homeless. They have nowhere to stay, nowhere to be stable. But if you put your mind on Jesus, and if you say, Lord, handle this situation, God, help me out of this situation. He said, I have formed you for myself. And if you was to declare praise to me, God says, I will help you tremendously. I love the Lord because he says, I will bless you. Isaiah 45 and verse 7 says, I formed the light and created darkness. I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord, does all these things. Then he says, rain down, you heavens, from above, and let the skies pour down righteousness. Let the earth open, and let them bring forth salvation, and let righteousness spring up together. I, the Lord, have created this. God has created this world, this universe. He's created you and I. He made us who we are. But God says, I have blew my breath into you. When he blew his breath into us, he gave us the ability to not have limitations, but to go as high as we can. That's why Philippians, he says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. 4:19, he says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Because when he blew his breath into us, he said, I am going to strengthen you to be so prosperous in this world, to do the things like you've never done before, to help you get where you've never been before. That's why he says in 19, he says, I will do a new thing, and it shall spring forth, and shall you not know it? I will even make a road. He says, I will do a new thing. Woo! Good God. God is saying, I want to do a new thing in you. I see the anointing in you. There's power that's laid dormant in you. But I got to bring that thing out of you. He says, and I got to read that one more time. I got to read it one more time. Isaiah 43:19. He said, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? God is telling us, I will do a new thing for you. He said, and I want to do a new thing in you. That's why I come to you early, and said, do not remember the former things, not consider the things of old. It's because of that old stuff, that old you, that old mindset, that old treacherous you, mean you, honoring you, take no mess you, that old you, you know, don't let that old you clog the future for the new you. He says, create a new you, renew your mind. And God says, I will do these things for you, and I will bless you like you've never been blessed before. But he says here in Jeremiah 7:23, he says, but this is what I command them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God. You shall be my people, and walk in all the ways I have commanded you, that it may be well with you. He says, obey my voice. This is God talking to you and I, saying, hey, I'm talking to you, but I need for you to obey my voice, because I'm about to do some things unto you that's going to be a new thing, that's going to bring you out of your situation. I am going to help you. But Psalms 118 and verse 24 says, this is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. But then he goes on to say in Psalms 118 and 25, save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. For blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, and he shall give us life. Bind the sacrifice with cords to be horns of the altar. And then they praise, and it says, you are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. And then Psalms 118 and verse 6 says, the Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? See, that's how you got to look at that thing. If I got God on my side, what can man do to me? But like I said earlier, when you're mentally hijacked, you feel like there's nothing that you could put your stable mind onto. But he says in 118, verse 17, he says, I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Whew, thank you, Jesus, for what you just said. I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. God wants to bless us. And then this is how I know he wants to bless us. Because he says in Psalms 115 and verse 14, he says, may the Lord give you increase more and more, you and your children. May you be blessed by the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. Good gracious. We serve a God that's awesome, that's right there for us. He's there to move for us. And that's why he says, tell them, Pastor, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? Tell them I'm ready to do some new things in their lives. Tell them I'm ready to do this thing like never before. Tell them I'm ready to make this thing happen like it never happened to them before. Tell them, my son, that I will work it out. Tell them, my son, that I am there for. Tell them, my son, let their yes be yes, and let their no be no, for I am God, and I will work it out for them. Saints, I want you to understand that the Lord we serve, he's concerned about everything that we are concerned about. Verse 11 says, I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. I want to take this opportunity, saints, to kind of break this thing down for you a little bit and help you to understand even more. Because we love God, we're going to go through some hardships. Because we believe in God, Satan is going to try to tempt us even more. Because we trust in God, because we just have intimacy with God, and because we reverence God more, Satan wants to take from us that reverence. Satan wants to take from us that belongings. Satan wants to take from us that yearning to be in the presence of God. He wants to take that from us because he knows if I take away your yearning, if I take away your intimacy, if I take away your relationship, you won't pray, you won't read the Bible, surely you won't go to church. You're not going to bring tithes and offerings to the house. And you're going to continuously talk crazy about the Lord. Saints, I want you to understand God hears every word that comes out of our mouth. And he says, I know your heart. He says, I know what you're going through. He says, I know how to fix your situation. Saints, let's give our hearts to God. Let him help you through this situation. Let him work it out for you. In the name of Jesus. He says, I will give you everything that you need. I will work it out for you. He says, I'll move for you. He says, I'll make it work for you. He says, and I'll do all these things. But look at Psalms 115, verse 1 says, not unto us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory, because of your mercy and because of your truth. Why should the Gentiles say, where now is my God? But our God is in heaven, and he does whatever he pleases. Good God Almighty, trust in the Lord. Our God is in heaven, and he does whatever he pleases. So thank you, Lord, for what you've done. But I do want you to hear this. We're in Psalms 101, and verse 5 says, whoever secretly slanders his neighbor, him I will destroy. The one who has a haughty look and a proud heart, him I will not endure. My eyes shall be on the fruitful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He who walks in a perfect way, he shall serve me. He who works deceit shall not dwell within my house. He who tells lies shall not contend in my presence. Earthly, I will destroy all the wicked of the land, but I will cut off all the evildoers from the city of the Lord. Woo! See, that's the God that we serve. He ain't playing with us, and he's not to be played with. Say that again. He ain't playing with us, and he's not to be played with. See, that's the kind of God. See, I want you to understand. So many people say, Lord God, if you do this for me, or if you do that for me, I will do this for you, God. And I will do that. God is not to be bartered with. You can't barter with Jesus. And then he says, don't make a vow to me, knowing that you're not going to fulfill that vow. You think that you're going to pimp God. You can't pimp God. I don't care how smooth your conversation is and how slick your words are. You cannot smoothly slick Jesus. He is a wise God. He is an omnipresent God. He even knew what you was going to say even before you even thought about it. Watch this. He knew last week what you was going to say at this very hour. That's how powerful the God that we serve. So don't play with Jesus. Don't make vows that you're not going to keep. Don't try to tell Jesus, if you do this for me, I'll do that. No, tell Jesus, I love you for who you are. And God, if I can do anything for you, let me give you me. Let me give you all of me. Help me, God, to get through this situation. God, I love you for who you are. I love you for what you've done for me. And I truly love you for what you're about to do to me. God, I thank you for what you've done. God, thank you for allowing me to go on a fast. So that in this fast, God, I'm going to have true intimacy with you. I want to bring you all of me. God, that house that I was talking about earlier, God, I want you to come into my house. And I want you to go into every room, whatever is not straight, straighten it out for me, God. I don't want to close no doors that you cannot enter. Come into my thought process, God, and help me through this situation that I will be able to say, okay, if it had not been for God on my side, whoo, don't know how I would have made it. So that's why I come tonight to tell you, God says, I will bless you. He says, I will work it out for you. He says, and I will move like never before. Because he says here in Psalm 30 and verse 5, for his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Psalms 30 says, I will exalt you, O Lord, for you have lifted me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord my God, I cry out to you and you have healed me. O Lord, you have brought my soul up from the grave. You have kept me alive that I should not go down to the pit. Right there is a good sermon. I don't know you listening to me. You a minister, pastor, apostle, bishop, elder, whoever. You behind that mic. Listen to what I just said. Oh, Lord, you have brought my soul up from the grave. There were so many things that tried to kill us even to this day. So many things. But we read in Isaiah 43. He says, don't remember the old things. Do not consider the past. He says, move away from that. Why? He said, because, Lord God, you have kept me alive, that I should not go down to that pit. Sing praises to the Lord, you saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holy name. That's why we have to give God praise. We have to continuously give him praise. We have to honor him. We got to say, God,
thank you for pulling me out of that grave.
And though you may not be in a physical grave, you're in a mental grave. You know that grave where I was talking to you earlier about, that mindset where I was talking to you earlier about being mentally hijacked, where you just feel lonely and you're feeling depressed. And you just feel like all hope is gone and just feel like somebody just sucked all the life out of you. Good God Almighty. That's that grave mentality that I'm talking about, that he says here, God, you brought me, my soul, from that grave. You pulled me out of this situation. Though you may not be in a physical grave, but you've been mentally hijacked. Your feelings are totally homeless, that they have nowhere to go to lay their heads, to call home. But I want you to get yourself in the car. Get your mouth like that and pull yourself up out of this situation and realize that if it had not been God for my side, I don't know where I would have been today. So you're not going to let me fall in this grave, God. He says here, God, you kept me alive and I should not go down in that pit. And so you raise yourself and say, God, you kept me alive. You didn't let that bullet hit me. You didn't let that car run over me. You didn't let the people do what they was trying to do to me. So God, thank you. And you got to sometimes pull yourself up out of that situation. And that's why David says, I got to praise you, God. He said, David praised him so hard, saying, he said he danced out of his clothes. That means that boy was serious. That means that boy said, God, if you had not been on my side, there's no way in the world I would have been where I'm at. So sometimes you just got to jack yourself up and say, hey, I know your mind has been mentally hijacked, but guess what? I come to pull you back out of this situation. Get yourself together, mind. Get yourself on track. And watch this. Give God the praise, because they pull you out of that situation. He made things work for you. He pulled you out of that situation. He got that bill paid. He gave peace to you. And when you were sick, there's no way in the world the doctor said you were going to pull out of this situation. But God said no. He said, I promise to give you life in the name of Jesus. So John 15 verse 7 says, if you abide in me and my word remain in you, I will give you your heart desire. God says, live. Jesus said, live. Jesus said, live. He said, live. Jesus said, live. You have kept me alive that I should not go down to the pit. Jesus say, live. Live with the intimacy of God. Then he says in Psalms 29, give them to the Lord. Oh, you mighty one. See what you call you? He called you a mighty one. Because a mighty one will jack his own self up. A mighty one will judge his own self. And a mighty one will judge himself. Hey, man, you ain't laying in that grave yet. Get yourself up. He said, and give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the water. The God of glory thunder. The Lord is over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. God is a majestic God. He's a powerful God. I just read to you from Psalms 29. He is a powerful God. Let me get back to where I was. Good gracious.
Thank you, Lord.
Get back to where I was. Because I want you to understand this thing here in this Bible here in chapter 45, where God was talking to Cyrus. He says thus said the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held. Whew. You know, we could put our own names right there. Thus say the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held. So many times we should have been counted out. So many times we should have lost out. So many times you could have turned a situation totally different. So many times, you could have turned a conversation totally different. You could have gotten one word out of that conversation, and you could have had that conversation based off of that one word and turned your whole thought process off because of that one word. But you didn't, because Jesus was holding your right hand. So where he says, thus say the Lord to anointed disciples whose right hand I held, you should put your hand and say, he held my right hand. He picked me up when I thought I was down. And then I like this part, to subdue nations before him and loose the armors of kings, to open before him double doors so that the gates would not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. That's the God that we serve in Isaiah 45 is where I was reading you. I just thank God because he loves us. He's blessed us. He's worked it out for us. He's moved before us. He says, do not remember the former things. We're back in Isaiah 43 again. He said, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Woo! Don't consider the things of old. Because God wants to bless us. God wants to work it out for us. But he just needs all of us, saints. He just needs all of us. Pastor, how do I give him all of me? Change your thought process. Change your mind. Stop speaking negativity over your situation. But speak life into your situation and watch it change. Satan brings situations. He brings circumstances so that he can cause you to become angry and frustrated and bitter and want to come at someone. But when you begin to speak life, this means that you recognize what's coming against you. You recognize what's there against you. And you recognize the circumstances in the situation. So you begin to speak life into that situation where they're coming to repossess, where they're coming to take from you, where they're coming like the roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. But he can't find you because you are hidden. You are hidden. You are hidden. You're hidden in the tabernacle of Jesus. And Psalms 91 says, 1,000 will fall at your side, 10,000 at your right side. None shall not come nigh thee. Why? Because you are hidden in the tabernacle. Oh, he's trying to cross me up, but I won't let him. In the tabernacle, in his pavilion, God has you in his bosom. He got you right where he wants you. So stay there. Stay right there. Keep praying. Stay right there. Keep crying out to God. Stay right. Don't beg him. Don't beg him. But command. Command. Lord, your word says this. Lord, your word says that. Heaven and earth shall pass away before your word does. So keep commanding. Keep crying out. Keep praising. Keep reading your Bible. Stay focused with Jesus. In the name of Jesus. This is what I want you to realize. He says, meditate on my word day and night. Sometimes when you read the Bible and you got it and you close the Bible and you left it at that, you turn and walked away. Well, when you walked away, you got your phone in your hand. Here come pop-ups. Here come Instagram. Here come TikTok. Here come all these different programs that just flood your mind. And now you read it. You did good. You read it. But you can't remember fully. So what you got to do now is when you finish reading your Bible, now take the opportunity to meditate on what you've read. See, when you meditate, you are putting that thought, you are putting what you've read into your spiritual bank. So that when it comes time for you to quote back that scripture, remind Satan of what happened in the Bible, Jesus pulled that person through, so shall he pull you through. You got to remind him that this too shall pass. And when you begin to meditate on his word, he says meditate on it day and night. That means God wants you to read his word and then begin to meditate on it. Just begin to meditate on it. I want you, and I want to challenge you this. I want you to meditate on the Lord's word as much as you meditate on looking at that phone. Oh, I done said something. I want to say that again. I want you to take the opportunity to meditate on the word of God like you pay attention to that cell phone. And I promise you, we guarantee that you will begin to learn more about who Jesus is, what he stands for, how he's going to pull you out of your situation, and what he'll do. And watch this. When you begin to pray with fervent prayer, God will pull you out of situations, and he will work it out for you. God says, I want to bless you, but I need to know that when I bless you, you're not going to give it back to that adversary that I snatched you out of the hands of. I will bless you. I will work it out for you. I will give you your heart desire. But I know all of you that's burdened and heavy laden, take my yoke and learn from me. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Because if my people who are called by my name will turn from their wicked ways and pray and seek my face, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. Why? Because I'm looked up to the hills from which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, who makes the heavens and the earth. He shall not suffer thy foot to be moved. All he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is my keeper. Shade upon my right hand. Sun shall smite me by day, nor the moon by night. Saints, God loves us. He loves us to the point where he gave his life for us. He gave his life for us. And then he turned and gave you and I the authority. The same thing he's done, we shall do the same. We shall do the same. So no longer get beat down. Oh, you're going to have some setbacks. Finances is not going to be like it should all the time. But guess what? God will bless you to make that mountain of a financial situation go away. Because you're going to bring your usurer. You're going to bring your tithes. You're going to bring it to the house of the Lord. And when you give your tithes to the house of the Lord, now God says, I can bless you. Now God says, I can work it out for you. You can't bring 5% to the house of the Lord and take that other 5%, go spend it at Walmart and Target. That's not what God said. He says, I'm a jealous God. He said, don't put no other God before me. So when you have God with 5% and take your other 5% and give it to Walmart at that special because you need that extra 5%, then you are having the sacrifice to God with Satan. God says, bring your usurer, bring your monies to the storehouse that I will bless your finances. So some of us, we are having a hard time financially because we can't find it in our thought process to give God a 10%. Do you know that if you got $100, all you got to do is just bless God with the $10 and the $90, he's going to let you do whatever you need to do. But then bring him an offering if you need to, if you want to. But he just wants 10. If he give you $1,000, he just said, bring $100 to my house that I may bless you. You got $900 to do whatever you need to do. But God says some of us won't do that. You got problems with bringing God your tithes. No more, saints. No more. Because you don't have a legal obligation to ask God for a financial blessing if you're not paying your tithes and bring them to the house. Why? Because he says you are operating under a curse, and then he says, just me at this. So pastors can pray all he wants to help your finances. But if you're not taking the opportunity for your finances, then you got to understand God will bless your finances. God, I don't know who I was talking to. I don't even know where I went in that direction. But I want you to understand, bless God with your finances so he can bless you. He did me. He'll bless you. He did First Lady. He'll bless you. He blessed Bishop. He'll bless you. He blessed that pastor. He'll bless you in the name of Jesus. So as we begin to close, I done got the sound, saints. I done got the sound. I got to close it up. I just love talking about Jesus. I can talk about him all night. But I done got the sound. And the sound is it's time to close Bible study. Because he says, I'm a God of order. Do things in decency and in order. So because of that, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for who you are, for what you've done. Thank you for the blessings. Thank you for working it out, God. Thank you that your mercy shall endure it forever in the name of Jesus. So God, circumcise our hearts tonight that we would understand who you are and what you made of and what you come here for. In the name of Jesus. And thank you, God, for the blessing of the hearers and the doers of your word. Thank you, God, for the participation that we received tonight. Thank you, God, for everyone that's listening. Have them to share this word, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Thank you now, God, for what you've done. Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. I want you to understand God does love you. He do want to help you. He will work it out. And you have to stop worrying. Put that thing in God's hand and let him do what he says he was going to do. He says, I will bless you. He said, I will work it out. He said, and I will love you. Do this now. so God can bless you. Now to him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly, and above all that you may ask or think, according to the powers worketh in you. Ephesians 3:20. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.